Today I joined by Dr. Namara Gabayo, Deputy Commissioner at Planning and Development Commission. Nice to meet you. All right. Since Dr. Abiy Ahmed took office in the year 2018, exactly in April, so many reforms had been undertaken and still being undertaken as well. The reform, I mean, cut across both socio-economic and a political segment, right? Today we're going to talk about the economic reform particularly, right? Majorly the 10-year development plan. Before exactly going to the 10-year development plan, I would like to ask you a very important question, right? The reform had been undertaken over the past 3 years, right? What are the major economic reforms gained or entertained through this course of time?
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, as you've mentioned, over the past almost 3 years, Ethiopia has been undergoing a broad-based, you know, political economic reforms, majorly in the economic, you know, dimensions. And what we call the homegrown economic reform has three major components in it. The first one is the macroeconomic reform. The second one is the sectoral economic reform. And the third component is the structural economic reforms. What initiated this homegrown economic reform is the problem that Ethiopia has, you know, sustained over the past few years in terms of properly managing our, you know, overall economy, be it, you know, the macroeconomic management, which really created huge imbalances, the way which we managed our, you know, monetary policies, fiscal policies, international trade policies. So there needs to be, you know, an intervention to really correct, you know, those macroeconomic, you know, imbalances that the country sustained. So the first, you know, component. That's why it's you know, emphasized on the macroeconomic, you know, management. So as I've mentioned earlier, it focused on looking into, you know, the overall financial and the monetary policies. We had a lot of, you know, problems related to our financial sector and the monetary policy, you know, related mismanagements that really created or that really caused the macroeconomic imbalances in that regard, you know, things like inflation, things like our foreign exchange policies, the way we, you know, allocate or mobilize, you know, development financing had a lot of, you know, issues. So there needs to be, you know, intervention in terms of reform. That's why the macroeconomic, you know, the homegrown economic reform emphasized on the macro element as, you know, one pillar or one component. The other dimensions is on the sectoral, you know, aspects. We had several problems when it comes to, you know, expanding production and productivities across the diverse sectors of the economy to really, you know, boost our growth, to create job opportunities, to also, you know, create a competitive economy both domestically and also in the international or global, you know, value chains. In the past, we solely focused on a few sectors of the economy, which were the agriculture and the industry. But Ethiopia had, you know, or has huge potential in terms of really looking into a multi-sectoral source of growth, or what we could call also, you know, diversified source of growth and also job opportunities. So the homegrown economic reform, the sectoral, you know, component of it, try to, you know, identify sectors which were not given attention in the past, such as the tourism sector, the mining sector, which really encompasses the overall natural resource sector. It includes also the petroleum, the petroleum, the natural gas sectors. And also we are in the 21st century where, you know, even though it is really, like, you know, stagnant, our urbanization, our telecom, you know, digital, ICT sectors are also growing. These sectors also bring opportunities. So we believed as a country that we should, you know, diversify our source of growth beyond agriculture industry, and also there is interlinkage between these sectors. So the government identified, you know, majorly five sectors, you know, agriculture, the manufacturing industry, the tourism sector, the mining sector, and also ICT, you know, sector as a source of growth. So this is also, you know, there needs to be policy reforms, you know, in order to really harness the potential that you know, our natural resources provide, the tourism sector provide, the agriculture sector provide. We need to really set a good, you know, institutional setups and a policy framework, you know, the alignment of policies across sectors, you know. All these were mainly emphasized in this homegrown economic reform process. The third component is what we called structural, you know, homegrown economic reforms. What we call in structural is, you know, it's really in its nature a cross-cutting, you know, challenges that our economy faced over the past years. It could be our, you know, competition policies, liberalization policies. It's also how we manage our cross-cutting sectors, such as, you know, the digital ICT sectors, the telecom sector, the energy sector, the transportation, you know, sectors, our trade facilitation sectors, you know, which mainly focuses on the logistics, you know, sector. All these, you know, elements, we call them structural, you know, reforms, in a sense that it really touches the structural formation of, you know, the overall economy, and it emphasized on that, you know, aspect is the issue of, you know, privatization, the issue of liberalization were, you know, were part of these structural, you know, issues, and also the issue of our ambitions to really join, you know, properly with global and regional trade agreements. You know, the reforms we are undertaking, you know, relates in one way or another, aligning our domestic policies with the global, you know, development commitments and regional development commitments. So these are broadly, you know, the structural aspects of our homegrown economic reforms. So as you've mentioned earlier, these are really, you know, very broad-based reform processes that the country, you know, had to go through, given the problem and the challenges that our economy faced over the past, you know, few years.
Okay, Ethiopian government has unveiled a 10-year development plan, right, which is under the theme of making Ethiopia a beacon of an African prosperity in the year 2030, right? And which is based on gaining a quality economy, right? Can you just tell us the overall idea, or the overall design, the overall program of this plan?
Yes, yeah. So yeah, as I've mentioned earlier, over the past 3 years, what Ethiopia, or what the government has been doing, was to set, you know, a foundation for a long-term, you know, development perspective by really, you know, quickly redressing the short to medium-term, you know, development challenges that Ethiopia had faced, which were largely really, you know, encompassed within the homegrown economic reform. But reforming alone were not enough. The country has to really set a long-term, you know, development vision. That's why the 10-year development, you know, plan that we've recently unveiled bases on the broad-based economic reforms, not really, you know, only economic, but as you've also mentioned earlier about the, you know, the political and the social reforms that the country is undergoing, were part of this, you know, were basis for this 10 years development plan. Because when you talk about development, development is not only, you know, the economy. It is also about the social, you know, sector development. It's also our, you know, institutional, political, and you know, cross-cutting, you know, organizational development that we envision as a country. So that is, you know, the interplay or the linkage between the homegrown economic reform and the 10-year development plan. So when you set a development plan, especially a long-term development plan, you need to really set a national, you know, development vision. What's your vision? It is the, from the vision that you are going to set the objectives, the priority sectors, and also the strategies through which you are going to achieve the goals and targets and the objectives. So in this context, which is really different from past experiences, Ethiopia has never had experience of developing a long-term development plans. It's usually very short to medium-term development plan experience that we have. But this time around, we put a 10-year development plan, which would also have a continuity. It's not really 10 years and we finish in 10 years down the line, but continuously setting a long-term perspectives in that sense. So the vision we set, or the this development plan set, is making Ethiopia beacon of prosperity in Africa. What we mean by that is Ethiopia has an immense potential in African context, whether you see it in terms of the size of our economy, the demographic transition that we are going through, the natural resource potential that we really have, and also we have really a commendable historical legacies in the African continent, as a leading country, if you really if that word is really a correct word in that sense. So we need to really set a vision that captures our our characteristics in that sense in the region or in the continent. So we need to be able to be an example, a beacon for our development achievements for other African countries. So that's the vision we set. But as you've mentioned earlier, this is a vision, and one of the main objective or pillar that we set in this 10-year development plan is we need to really make sure that the economic growth that we bring or we create has to really have a characteristics of quality. So that's why we identify ensuring quality economic growth and shared prosperity as one of a key pillar area, and also main objective in that. Is what we mean by quality economic growth is that if you look back the growth performance of Ethiopia over the past few decades, Ethiopia has registered high high economic growth rate, which were primarily driven by large scale public investments that the government intervened to provide large scale public development projects, infrastructure, so to create effective demand domestically. But even though we have that high growth, high economic growth rate, in terms of its impact on the living standards of the citizens or the society, there were huge gaps or challenges we faced. The economic growth that we created did not really create decent and enough job opportunities for citizens, because we solely focused on providing public infrastructures, which were not really equally focused on expanding production and enhancing productivities across the diverse sectors of the economy. And the growth itself is really concentrated in a particular place, especially in Addis, where regions away from Addis and geographical space away from Addis really lacked job opportunities, and the diverse societies that Ethiopia has did not really enjoy an equitable distribution of economic growth. The other is also the financing approach that Ethiopia has pursued, whether it was domestic or external financing mobilizations, mobilization policy the government followed. It really created huge gaps in our macroeconomic imbalances. It really created an inflationary pressure, because you only boosted the demand side, but equal emphasis were not given on the supply side in terms of expanding production and productivities across the diverse sectors of the economy. So all these things are what we really try to put in perspective as lack of quality economic growth. So in this 10-year development plan, we need to really ensure quality economic growth. We need to keep the high trajectory of economic growth. Without that, we cannot really bring a broad-based, you know, development for this country, and also in terms of, you know, ensuring quality life and better living standards by really arresting the problem of inflation. We need to really have a proper policy reforms. That's why I mentioned earlier the homegrown economic reforms, albeit it was really, you know, a short term. There were, you know, quite encouraging policy reforms in place. Need to really mitigate and resilient and adapt to, you know, quickly to such, you know, unforeseen, you know, shocks and risks. So that's what we mean by, you know, resilient economy in the, yeah, in our 10-year development.
Okay, how do you put the current Ethiopian economic growth and the per capita income, the GDP, all together? Because these days some foreign media are broadcasting or televising that as if Ethiopia is under brick in economy. You need to brainwash this misinformation.
We're really now trying to sustain the high, you know, the high growth trajectory, high growth economic, high economic growth trajectory, which we really, you know, be able to make over the past, you know, 2-3 years. Ethiopian economy has faced huge, huge macroeconomic imbalances, and also in terms of competitiveness and productivity. And also at the same time, we face these, you know, shocks that I've mentioned, you know, earlier about the, you know, the COVID pandemic. You know, despite all these challenges, Ethiopia's economy, thanks to the homegrown economic reform that we really, you know, boldly took, you know, reform initiatives across, you know, the diverse sectors of the economy, starting from the macroeconomy, we were able to really, you know, cushion the economy not to be really, you know, badly affected by these shocks, and also corrected the imbalances, you know, the macroeconomic challenges, you know, the unemployment, the inflation, you know, that we've inherited from the past. You know, that's why the homegrown economic reform really emphasized, you know, to arrest all these challenges, which are really, you know, bringing some fruits, you know. So these reforms are paying off even during the short term, let alone the potential that it really, you know, lays for this 10-year development plan. For example, in terms of our, you know, trade performance, you know, our export performance across the diverse sectors of the economy, in the agriculture, in the mining sector, is really, you know, taking off over the past, you know, few years during this reform process. A broad-based work is also being done in terms of arresting this inflationary problem. Ethiopia's inflationary problem is not a short-term, you know, problem. It was, you know, a structural, you know, challenges that this economy has inherited over the past, you know, few decades. So the reform process is really targeting to you know, to really, you know, arrest this inflationary problem by bringing, you know, price stability, and also in terms of, you know, creating opportunities for the private sector. You know, if you see the credit allocations that the government has been undertaking over the past few years, so to increase the roles and participation of, you know, private sectors in the diverse sectors of the economy, so to create, you know, job opportunities for the you know, our citizens, is quite, you know, encouraging. It is because of that, you know, all broad-based efforts and initiatives that we really, you know, registered strong economic, you know, growth during the previous, you know, fiscal year, during where the global and regional economy faced huge challenges. And also the reform process is really, you know, continuing and, like, you know, adapting to these, you know, shocks and challenges that we've, you know, externally inheriting, or, you know, exogenous shocks that is not really, you know, up to only the domestic initiatives that we take, because these regional and global economies are interlinked, and the challenges that we face. So putting the current status of the Ethiopian economy, we are, you know, be able to sustain this, you know, economic growth, which is really, you know, creating good positive, you know, partnership, whether it is by multinational organizations or our bilateral and multilateral, you know, development partners. And Ethiopia is keeping that goodwill to continue, really, you know, with this reform process, so that we really achieve these development goals and targets that we set. If you take our, you know, broader GDP, we've surpassed, you know, during the past fiscal year, the 2 billion, you know, USD in terms of the size of the economy. This is a quite, you know, encouraging stuff. As I mentioned earlier, the size of our economy is one of our potential. That's why we set a bigger vision, you know, for this economy. In terms of the per capita income growth as well, we've now reached, you know, the low bar or the lower, you know, middle income categories, where our current, you know, per capita stand is in terms of USD at 1,080, you know, USD. So these are, you know, quite encouraging stuff that, you know, we're seeing through broad-based, you know, homegrown economic reform. But there are a lot of challenges that the government itself admitted to really arrest all these challenges, whether it is the inflation problem, the unemployment, the lack of competitiveness and productivity across the diverse sectors of the economy. That's why we have this bold, you know, ambitious, you know, development plan, 10-year development plan in place.
Ethiopia used to implement growth and transformation plan of 5 years previously, but now the 10-year strategic plan has been designed and being implemented, right? What is the very unique quality of this one, and why avoiding the previous strategic plan is needed?
Yeah, two things. The first one is, as we mentioned earlier, the process that we went through to prepare this development plan makes it really, you know, different from the previous development, you know, process, development planning process, especially the growth and transformation plan. As I mentioned earlier, we really put it in place a good working, you know, institution in terms of, you know, liaising with the sectoral line ministries to create this mixed, you know, top-down approach and bottom-up approach through which the macro institutions and the sectoral institutions, you know, come together collaboratively and work in terms of, you know, preparing development plan, which were not the case during the growth and transformation plan, because during the growth and transformation plan, it was exclusively done by ad hoc committees, which are like, you know, set up for a short-term, you know, assignments and come up together, and few individuals really set development goals and target for this country, which is really, you know, foreign to the sectoral ministries as well, because it was not designed or prepared by them. So the goals and targets set by committees are really, you know, foreign to the sectoral, you know, ministry. But during this 10-year development process, we really made sure that this development plan preparation process has to be really inclusive, both within the government actors. We need to really, you know, create that collaborative relationship between the macro and the sectoral, you know, institutions. We've also, you know, undertaken a lot of workshops and consultation forums, so to, you know, bring in other, you know, actors, which are largely non-governmental actors, you know, the think tanks, the civic societies, the individual, you know, expertise in different sectors of the economy. This really, you know, makes it different from, you know, the previous development plan process of Ethiopia. The other is the content and the way we see the Ethiopian problem. In the past, as I've mentioned earlier, we often focus on short-term, medium-term, you know, goals and targets. But the problems and the challenges that we face in Ethiopia in terms of, you know, our development endeavor, it is really deep-rooted and structural. Unless a long-term vision, you know, you cannot really, you know, properly put in place sequentially or, you know, prioritize our development goals and targets. So this development plan has set a longer vision. As I mentioned earlier, the 10-year development plan is one step, you know, at a time. We are also preparing, you know, beyond the 10-year development plan, which really, you know, we are framing it as Ethiopia 2050. So what our economy would look like in 30, 40 years, you know, down the line. So you set that long-term vision, but in terms of implementation, you need to really have break down this in terms of annually, 2, 3, 4 years, you know, planning process. So this makes it different from growth and transformation plan, which exclusively focuses on the short-term, you know, development challenges.
Each ministry has mandated to come up with its own 10-year strategic plan, right? Did all they submit the plan?
Yes.
And who monitor and evaluate that?
So the way we have done this 10-year development plan is we took, you know, a mixed approach in a sense. To some extent it was, you know, top-down approach, and also at the same time, you know, bottom-up approach of, you know, development planning process. What we mean by, you know, top-down approach is, in order to have, you know, a national development plan, we need to really have a proper macroeconomic framework, okay, at the national level, whether it is our fiscal policies, our monetary policies, our financial policies, our trade policies. All these need to, you know, we need to have a proper macroeconomic framework. So which was, you know, done by, in collaboration with other macroeconomic institutions such as the National Bank of Ethiopia, the Ministry of Finance, and we took, you know, as a Federal Planning and Development Commission, the leading and the coordinating role of that activity. At the same time, so once you set the macroeconomic, you know, framework, goals and targets, you need to align this with the sectoral goals and targets, which is exclusively the mandate and the rights of sectoral ministries, which works, you know, in line with the, you know, the regional governments and also sub-regional, you know, governments. So what we've done is we need to really align these development processes, which was, you know, actually, like, you know, in the past it was not the case that our development experience or development plan experience was.
So you haven't faced, mandate overlapping or resource overflow?
It's not really mandate overlapping, but you need to really align the macro goals and target with the sectoral target. So we play the facilitating role, if you like, and the coordinating role, the leading role in that sense, as a, you know, Federal Planning and Development Commission. Because sectors need to sit down, you know, with other sectors. We need to really make sure that the sectoral interlinkage between the diverse, you know, sectors of the economy need to be, you know, aligned, so that it really, you know, liaise or have a proper, you know, feedback loop with the macroeconomic goals and targets. So that is, you know, the bottom-up approach. They exclusively, you know, do the planning and the planning processes. As I said earlier, sectoral ministry, for example, if you take the Ministry of Agriculture, has its, you know, structural, you know, arrangements that it has, a arrangement with the regional governments. Okay, so they do that, you know, sectoral, you know, plan. But this sectoral plan need to, you know, get aligned with the macroeconomic goals and targets. That's why I said earlier, the mixed approach, the top-down approach and the bottom-up approach were done. And yeah, I was actually mentioning earlier before you intervened, the in the past, Ethiopia's development experience were like, you know, exclusively planned from the center. You know, if you take the case of growth and transformation plan, ad hoc committees are formed, you know, were formed on economic sector, on social sectors, political sector, government sectors, and they sit down and, like, you know, prepare a national development plan as a ad hoc, you know, committees. But over the past, you know, 2 years, what we have done, we're like, you know, we had to really break that, you know, type of planning processes, because planning is, you know, macro. At the same time, it's also micro. What I mean, micro sectoral, you know, level issues, for which, you know, the resource and the mandates are, you know, exclusively for the sectoral ministries, but without, you know, proper coordination between the macro institutions and the sectoral institutions, you cannot really have a proper, you know, development planning. You've also mentioned earlier about the implementation issues. When you have that kind of synchronization between the macro and the sectoral, you know, planning processes, we also create, you know, good, transparent and accountable, you know, institutional arrangements, so that all these, you know, development goals and targets are properly monitored and evaluated with the sectoral, you know, ministries.
I appreciate it. What are the major challenges and shortcomings you've been facing in designing and proposing the 10-year plan?
Yeah, the first problem is the capacity issue. What I mean by the capacity is, as I mentioned earlier, over the past few decades, Ethiopia had really a bad experience in terms of having a good institutional development in place, whether it is about, you know, the overall government or public sector, you know, arrangements that we had in place were not, you know, capable enough in terms of independency, in terms of meritocracy, the quality to provide, you know, proper public services to the overall, you know, public. We had huge gaps in that area. So this is one of the, you know, the challenges that we really face as a country. And also it is for this reason that the homegrown economic reform really took a bold, you know, initiative in that, you know, we were intervening in a bold way, reforming our, you know, policy framework, legal frameworks, and also institutional framework that were, you know, in the past, you know, really untouched. This is, you know, one of the biggest challenges that we face, and the work needs to continue. And we've also identified in the 10-year development plan the institutional transformation, which really takes into consideration not only, like, you know, the organizational capacity challenge that we face, but the overall, you know, institutional setups that we have in place in Ethiopia. The other is the data challenges. You know, Ethiopia has really, you know, huge challenges in terms of data management. Without proper data, without proper evidence, you cannot really have a proper policies in place. And over the past, you know, 2 years, there were, you know, quite encouraging activities that have been done in order to promote and strengthen our data management system, whether it is a public, you know, administrative data or any other types of data that we really, you know, manage as a country, so that we use it for a proper planning and for a proper public policy making. And there are several other, you know, challenges, but I've mentioned earlier the homegrown economic reform also, you know, had an ultimate purpose of really, you know, tackling those challenges. So it could be used, you know, it is used as a basis for this 10-year development plan.
Particularly your commission, this Planning and Development Commission, is heading this plan, right? Before directly going to this proposal of designing a 10-year development plan, the government has conducted a research, right? Over the past decade or so, Ethiopia has registered poor economic growth, right? What were the challenges or the reason for such poor economic growth in your research?
Yes. So before launching or the work of this 10-year development plan, there were broad-based, you know, research that were undertaken. The research undertaken by the government itself, by, you know, different stakeholders, you know, research institutes, think tanks, universities, and also we had also a case where we had the research support from abroad as well. The first thing that had been done was to properly evaluate our past, you know, development endeavor, especially this 10-year development plan, looked closely into the past 10-year economic performances aligned with the growth and transformation plan, both, you know, plans that started back in 2003 to 2012 in Ethiopia's, you know, fiscal year. So as I've mentioned earlier, the challenges were like, you know, what I've exactly mentioned earlier, that were redressed in the homegrown economic reform. We had huge macroeconomic imbalances, whether it was our growth financing approach, the way we mobilized domestic resources to finance our growth, the way we, you know, managed our external debt, and also our overall, you know, financial policies in terms of, you know, mobilizing, you know, deposit for saving, domestic saving, and also the allocation policies, you know, the credit allocation policies for various, you know, business and investments we followed, where, you know, it had huge gaps, you know, from administrative point of view, and also from, you know, market orientation point of view. So the homegrown economic reform, you know, really, you know, captured that area. Hence, we had, you know, these broad-based homegrown economic reform. It also includes our fiscal policies, the way we managed our taxation policies, how we collected or mobilized domestic revenues in that sense. And also there were huge gaps in terms of, you know, productivity and competitiveness of our overall economy, both at the macro level and at the sectoral level. So these were, you know, the challenges that we had, you know. If you take our, you know, agricultural sector, it did not receive a proper, you know, attention or proper, you know, incentive structure in order to really, you know, boost the production and productivity of the sector, and also other, you know, sectors that were really neglected over the past that I've mentioned earlier about the mining, the tourism sector, the, you know, the digital or the ICT, you know, sector. These were the challenges that we faced over time. So the study conducted, we're, you know, trying to look into these, you know, problems, and also came up with the different recommendations and, you know, insights on how to really, you know, manage our overall economy, how we should be planning our development, you know, goals and targets, both at the macro and at the sectoral level. So these were, you know, the studies that we've undertaken before really, you know, going into the nitty-gritty of, you know, preparing the plan document itself.